Good Thursday morning. Welcome to the Rays of Light, Rainbows of Peace, Divine Will Prayer Cenacle. We are on lesson three of Louisa Picaretta, the tiny little mama of the tiny little children of the divine will, a day of recollection given back in May of 2009 by Father Thomas B. Celso, BDV. We'll get straight to it. I'm actually traveling, so we'll need to do the shortened version of the prayer cenacle today. I'm actually in New Orleans attending the 2024 annual conference of the Catholic Psychotherapy Association. And they're doing wonderful things, men and women that are targeting healing from a Catholic perspective. And the conference here is called Be Not Afraid, Defending the Family. And just again, just wonderful work. If you get a chance to look up this group, Catholic Psychotherapy Association, you can become an affiliate member or just a donate straight to them, supporting their mission, which is authentic Catholic life, helping us to live as God designed us to live, which is in His divine will. So it's all works together for those who love God. All right, well, let's get going without any further delays. Fiat.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. By the Sacred Heart of Jesus, and the Immaculate Heart of Mary, one with Louisa, the little daughter of the divine will, I enter into the holy divine will. Come, divine will, come beat in my every heartbeat, come breathe in my every breath. Come pray, adore, and reign in me. In the name of everyone and everything, past, present, and future, in, with, through, and for Jesus, Mary, and Louisa, in, with, and for all. That all may be for the glory of God and the good of all souls, giving to God as if all lived in the most holy divine will, united with creation, redemption, and sanctification. Praying as one in that one eternal act, for the kingdom to come, reign on earth. Fiat.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit. Our Lady, Queen of Saints, Our Lady of America, St. Paul, St. Athanasius, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, Amen. All I could think of was Anastasia, and I knew it wasn't Anastasia. Okay, so I know we're going very slowly on this, but don't worry, we will complete this. We're only on page three, and we got to go to page what? Well, just so that you know, we're gonna. This is what I'm going to do. Hopefully, if we have the opportunity on August 15th, so we will continue where we leave off with this. Okay. Today, Volume 26, June 27th, 1929. In the very creation, there is a continuous transmission Jesus says, our fiat created the heavens. Our fiat studied them with stars. Our fiat called to life matter in order to do it. See, God is in charge of everything. The divine fiat created the sun. But the divine fiat called to life the light and heat as material with which to form the sun. The divine fiat created Adam. First, I, God, formed his soul. And then my divine will transmitted itself with Adam's soul in order to form its kingdom in Adam. So Adam had the kingdom of God within him. Again, that's why the great blessing of this great gift of the divine will is to begin to live the life that Adam lost. Now, what's so beautiful about this, and we have to understand that going back to that prayer that we prayed right at the beginning, come, Holy Spirit, fill the hearts of your faithful Catholics, enkindle in them the fire of your love, that's the divine will, send forth your spirit, and we will be recreated, and then you will renew the face of the earth. See, what God, this renewal of the face of the earth, it's going to go, this is how much God loves us. Everything's going to be redone. That's our job with Louisa, to redo everything. So when you go to a church and you hear a priest maybe give a bad homily, instead of screaming at the priest, you say, number one, thank you, Jesus, for showing me this. Number two, Lord, I'm sorry it's happening to you. And number three, I want to repair this, not only for this homily, but for all homilies, past, present, and future. And so what happens is you are renewing the face of the earth. Now, what's so beautiful about this gift of the divine will, it's going to look as if Adam never sinned. That's how much repair is coming. And what the devil is going to recognize is that no matter how wicked and evil and hatred, how hate-filled he was, God is greater. And God, through the Holy Spirit, is going to repair everything and everyone. And the devil's going to realize that he was a total failure, complete failure. Because what God wants to do is God cannot have what he wants. I mean, God cannot not have what he wants. God has to have what he wants. And he wants us to live in paradise. He wants us to be his children. So he's given everyone right now the freedom of what they want to do. He gives Lucifer the freedom. He gives Lucifer everything that he wants. Lucifer wants hell. He's got it. We want to kill our children through abortion. We can do it. We want to live alternative lifestyles. We can do it. We want to be Catholic. We can do it. God gives us everything that we want. So, again, God wants to repair, redo. And Jesus says to Louisa, even if only one soul, even if you're the only one that does this, Louisa, in the name of everyone and everything, I will be eternally happy. But Jesus is offering this life of Louisa to us as well. He's offering us to live in the kingdom of God on earth. This is the fulfillment of the Our Father, as the saints possess it in heaven. So he says very clearly, he says, there is that one thing that has come out of us triune God and created by us triune God in which there isn't this transmission of human and divine. See, everything that God created was for humans. He says everything that God created was a work of God. The only life of God is a human soul. That's the only life of God, a human soul. And what our God is asking of us to do is to recognize the truth. And that's what Humani Vitae said. Understand what human life is. It's a life of God. And when the church, when humans rejected Humani Vitae, what it means to be human, they rejected now what God, I mean, God would have given us what it means to be divine way back when. But because they rejected what it means to be human, God has to wait and now give us, at this time, what is divine. If we are faithful and obedient Catholics, obedient to the Church, obedient especially to Humani Vitae, then God will give us what it means to be divine, how to have divine life. Vatican II was a love letter to Jesus' love letter to his church. And Vatican II was completely rejected. That's why Pope John Paul II said, I want to explain to you what Vatican II means. That's why Pope Benedict is saying to us, I want to explain to you what Vatican II means. If we had lived Vatican II back in, 40 years ago, we would now know how to live. Abortion wouldn't be here. Euthanasia wouldn't be here. Alternative lifestyles wouldn't be here. We would be all living Catholic lives, abundant lives. So what does John Paul do? You read everything that John Paul wrote. It was to help us understand Vatican II. Look at Pope Benedict is writing. It's to help us to understand Vatican II. We have to understand that this love letter of Jesus to his church is to help us to live this life right now. And that's why it's so foolish for those to protest against the church. Protest against the vicar of Christ on earth. I mean, this is divine life that our God wants us to possess. So he says very clearly, there's not one thing that has come out of us, triune God, created us by a triune God, that there isn't the transmission of human and divine. In our most beautiful works, the creation, the Immaculate Mary, Mother, the Word human, Jesus, the Word made man, the human and divine are so bound together as to be inseparable. That's why a real beautiful image of Our Lady is she's always with Jesus. It's inseparable. And I like the cover of this magazine, of the Virgin Mary and the Kingdom, I really like because Our Lady's holding Jesus' hand, and Jesus' hand is going towards Our Lady. It's the Mother and Queen, King and Savior. We have to understand the new Adam and the new Eve. You look at Adam, I mean, God is so much, he's so great. Adam was the father of Eve. Eve came from Adam's side. Eve was the offspring of Adam. And now what you have Mary. The offspring of Mary is the Son of God. I mean, how beautiful this is that our God gives us Adam and Eve, and now Jesus and Mary. And now what's really spectacular, in volume 15, Jesus says, Adam was enticed by his offspring, by his daughter, and fell. So I, God, give to you, Louisa, my daughter, this gift of the divine will, so that you, Louisa, will give this gift to the Pope, back to the man. I mean, everything is full circle. How beautiful this is. And if you're looking at it from a human perspective, you're going to go, how can Jesus be the father of Louisa and Mary be the mother of, how can Adam be the father of Eve? And I mean, what's so beautiful, you have to see everything with the eyes of Christ. See, to live in God's divine will, you have to give up your intellect. Like I said before, we're only using 10% of our brain, if that. God wants us to see things from his perspective, from a divine perspective. And not only that, he says, give up your memory. Most of our memories is somebody did this to me. Somebody did that to, my family. Somebody did this. They're saying this. They're doing that. That's where our memory is. Jesus says, do this in memory of me. Louisa loves Jesus so much that she's always focused on Jesus. Always focused on Mary. That's why we want to be linked to Louisa. She's not thinking about herself. When Jesus said to her, go to bed when she was 17 and stay there, and she could walk, and she was obedient. Then Jesus says, don't eat anymore. Then Jesus says, don't sleep anymore. And Louisa was obedient. What's so amazing about Louisa is that she loves Jesus so much. She loves Mary so much. That when we link ourselves to Louisa, we also begin to possess that life, that love of Jesus and Mary. So when we give up our intellect, it's perfect. Give up our memory, it's perfect. Now we can give up our human will. We choose you choose your the human will. You choose to give up the human will to live in the divine will by your free will. Thank you very much. My mind went blank there. See, it's the free will. See, God, our free will is so important to God. What are you going to do with your free will? You can even live in your human misery, your worry, your fear, your anxiety, your complaints, your negativity, your sin. Or you could say, I want to live in God's most holy divine will. That's what Jesus says. I have a food that you do not know of to do the will of God. And as Jesus explains to Louisa, to live in the will of God. I have a food that you do not know of. So again, why do we receive Holy Communion every day? What, to prepare ourselves for the perennial communion with God. I mean, it's so wonderful to be Catholic. It's so wonderful to have the prayers of the church, the dogma and doctrine of our church. Because if you really want to be faithful to Christ and His church, the next step is to live in His divine will. Again, this is magnificent. So, he says, the human and the divine are so bound together as to be inseparable. So the heavens are brimful, full of God, narrating God's glory, God's power, God's wisdom. So every time we look at a sunrise or a sunset, God is saying, I am going to return. He says that every morning and every evening, I am going to return. Why do you have the rose vestments of Gaudete Sunday and Laetare Sunday? It's right before Christmas, right before Easter. Why? Because it's to prepare us for Christ's return. Christ is coming. And so, you look at Our Lady of Guadalupe. She's wearing the pink vestments. Why? Jesus is coming every morning at sunrise. I am returning. Every sunset, Jesus is saying, I am returning. And if you're stuck in, humanness, oh, a pretty sunset, pretty sunrise, you're not seeing the beauty of God. You're not seeing the glory of God. You're not seeing the power of God. I mean, we have to begin to see things from Christ's perspective. It's all around us. St. Thomas Aquinas tells us this. You know God is in existence by what is around you. You know God is here. And most especially, with eyes of faith, you see Jesus in the Blessed Sacrament. Jesus, God, holy, holy, Lord God of Sabaoth. That which looks like bread and tastes like bread is worthy of worship. It is our God, body, blood, soul, and divinity. Again, being Catholic is so wonderful. It is so magnificent. To go to any Catholic church and to kneel before God. St. Teresa says this is the only time that we can freely love God, because when we see God in heaven, we're going to have to love Him. He is so beautiful, so holy, so perfect, so loving, that we will have to love God. There's no way we can't. So this is the only time where we can freely love God. And if it's in part of your schedule, and it should be a part of your schedule as a Catholic, it's important to go to Him, to spend time with our Eucharistic Lord, to adore Him and to love Him and to praise Him and to thank Him and to glorify Him, to truly worship Him. I mean, yet the churches are empty. The churches are locked. The Holy Father said, John Paul II said, he wanted perpetual adoration in every parish. And now they're lacking churches because of the swine flu. We don't want anybody to catch any swine flu, so we don't want you to be with Jesus. Well, the place not to get the swine flu is with Jesus, praying in front of Him, adoring Him. I mean, they're thinking worldly. Our God wants us to begin to think divinely. So He says, what's brimful of God, full of God, narrating God's glory, narrating God's power, narrating God's wisdom? The Immaculate Queen Mary, the bearer of God, the bearer of Jesus' humanity, the bearer of the incarnate Word. I mean, that's what God has given to the Catholic Church. That's why if you have a statue of Mary and it's outside, and it should have a statue of Mary, and it should be outside. Make sure you crown her queen of your yard, mother and queen of your family. I mean, really, it's, you know, I told you that story about the family that wanted their house consecrated to the Sacred Heart of Jesus, the Immaculate Heart of Mary, $1 million house, more than that. Beautiful, everything, grand piano, you know, stained glass windows, beautiful. And I said, well, where's your statue of Jesus and Mary? Oh, let me go get it. And they come out with 3-inch plastic statues. You know, and this is why I get in trouble. I said, and you call yourselves Catholic? Look at this house. And you have Jesus and Mary, these plastic statues that you wouldn't even dare put in your car? I mean, if you have a statue of Our Lady, make sure she's honored. You know, I mean, if you have a statue of Jesus, make sure he's honored. There should be a prominent place. Now, in most houses, the TV is in the prominent place. The TV is their tabernacle. What we want as Catholic, you should have a crucifix in every room, a holy water font in the entrance of your house, entrance to every room. You should have an image of Jesus, an image of Mary, and when you're in the divine will, an image of Louisa. I mean, Jesus, when you read this, you're not going to believe how much he loves Louisa, his little daughter. Now, he says, now wanting to make my divine will known after first transmission, God made in Eden, and that was rejected from me by Adam. And in order to be able to put the kingdom of a divine fiat out in the field again, in the world again, it was necessary for me, Jesus, to form the second transmission. And how could I, God, do it if I, God, did not intertwine with another soul, with bonds most inseparable in the knowledges, in the light, and in the very life of my eternal volition? Okay, this is what he says about Louisa. I have intertwined with another soul. I have basically, as he breathed into Adam, he breathed into Louisa. Why? Because Louisa has the true life of Jesus and the true life of Mary. Louisa, being human, now has the responsibility of giving this life, abundant life, to the world. And if I, God, did not intertwine with you, Louisa, in the divine will, transmitting you, Louisa, into divine will, and divine will into you, Louisa, would not have felt within you either the divine will life and the divine will's permanent light. Again, remember, St. Padre Pio said, Louisa is a new sun that will give light to the whole world. Nor would you, Louisa, have felt within you the necessity to love the divine will, and the yearning to know the divine will more. I mean, that's what's so great about this. I remember in the 80s, we had sheets of mimeograph sheets of paper of Louisa. Never did we think. I mean, I went to Rome in 1990. I went to the secret archives of the Vatican, and I said, I'm here to pick up the writings of Louisa, hoping they would just give them to me. And they just said, get out of here. They said, we've destroyed these. I said, no, they're here. I'm here. And then 6 years later, I go back in. The same guy who said we've destroyed them says, oh, here they are. You have permission of the bishop now, archbishop. Here they are. But, you know, what's great is we have all the writings. Again, this wasn't supposed to happen. I mean, these writings are so amazing that there are some who don't want anybody to read these. And the reason is because they know what they're going to do. These writings are going to transform the face of the earth. So when, you know, everybody's having tea parties, you know, what we want to have is we want to have prayer meetings in the divine will. This is what's so spectacular. Don't panic about what's happening. You know, the swine flu. This happened in 1976. The same thing. They did the same thing in 1976. They wanted to inoculate everybody. And as a matter of fact, numerous people died because of the inoculations in Pittsburgh. again, it's right on the internet if you want to look. It's nothing to worry about. Jesus has got a greater plan. So he says, and so this is why I, God, put you, Louisa, and me, Jesus, in this condition. You, Louisa, of giving to me, and I, Jesus, giving to you, Louisa. And that reciprocal giving, I, God, would form the knowledge that I, God, wanted to give to you, Louisa. And the transmission of my divine will with your human will, Louisa, was realized, rendering you, Louisa, the conqueror of the great good that I, Jesus, was doing to you, Louisa. So it's not even Louisa's done nothing. Jesus has done this. He says, now I want to bring the kingdom of God on earth as it is in heaven. 2,000 years of prayer, may your kingdom come, may your will be done, is now coming to completion. And what's so beautiful is that Jesus has said that a sure sign of his return is the release of these writings. In 1996, the writings came out of the Vatican. In 1997, Our Lady said to Father Gobi, everything is complete. Well, how could everything be complete? Well, because in Mexico City, they were reading all 36 volumes by 1997. The first place in the world. Not even in Corrado. Now, what's so spectacular about this is it didn't go the way. I mean, people were very upset that the writings disappeared. Not disappeared. The writings were spread out through the world. And as the Archbishop said, it's like trying to, you pour a bottle of water into the ocean and trying to get that bottle of water back in, from the ocean. It's not going to happen. It's out there. And I cannot wait until the official translations are done. We've got the best so far. But the official translations aren't here yet. So we have again, with like St. Faustina, I remember they retranslated a few things to make it theologically correct. And they might have to do that to Louisa. That was a possibility. But what we have is we have exactly what Louisa said. And that's why this is so beautiful for us to read this, to study this, and to put this into practice. Volume 26, July 14th, 1929. Now, after I became sure about you, Louisa, and I, Jesus, secured my work, again, how did he become sure? Because she was obedient. Go to bed and stay there. She was obedient. After I was sure about you, Louisa, and I, God, was sure, secured my work in you, Louisa, and my acting changed. Then my acting changed. I made you, Louisa, break the silence, and the ardor of my instructions of my speaking was such and so great that I, Jesus, could call you, Louisa, I read that before, the cathedra of my divine will, the secretary of its most intimate secrets. Okay, so again, here, the seat of Louisa. Again, the seat of Moses, the seat of Peter, the chair of Peter, the chair of the bishop, the cathedra, speaking the dogma and doctrine of the church. Louisa now is the doctrine of the divine will is coming from Louisa. I've seen people say, well, I don't have to read this. I want to read something else. And you go, but you're not reading divine will. Well, I'm really interested in Saint so-and-so. Good. God bless you. That's wonderful. That's saintly. But it's not divine will. Where does this knowledge come from? It comes from Louisa. Louisa is the cathedra, the seat of the divine will. Louisa is the secretary of the divine will's most intimate secrets, such that you, Louisa, were unable to contain them all within yourself, and I, God, commanded you to manifest them to my priest. And that's why St. Honorable de Francia here is so important. The Holy Father made St. Honorable de Francia the man that you pray to for vocations. He's in charge of vocations. He was in charge of also Melanie of La Salette. Melanie of La Salette helped him start the Daughters of Divine Zeal. The Daughters of Divine Zeal is where Louisa stayed. Father Inibele is, as a matter of fact, the Holy Father on Father Inibele's ordination day said to the world that there's going to be a year of praying for priests starting June 19th, the feast of the Curia of Ars. But when he made the announcement, it was on his ordination day. He is very, very important. We have to understand this. He is the first one to die living in the divine will. Why? Because he read and he studied and he put into practice volume 1 through volume 19. And when you go to Italy, when you go to St. Anthony's Church, where the Rogationists are, as you enter into the church, to your left, there's a image of St. Honorable de Francia hovering in the sky, glowing in light. This is what Jesus taught Luisa. As a matter of fact, where they got that image of Father Inibele in the air, glowing in light, was what Jesus told Luisa. That document, I think it was in volume 20, between 20 and 23, around there, somewhere around there, was given to the postulator, and he used that to what Jesus told Luisa show the world St. Honorable de Francia. Now, it's really interesting. I was with him, the postulator, at the when St. Honorable de Francia became canonized. And afterwards, he came up to me and he dusted off his hands. He goes like that and he goes, "Father Inibele, done." He says, "Now, Luisa." Now, you think about that. Where was, his name is Father Pignatelli. Where is Father Pignatelli? Where was he born? It was 14 miles from Corrado. He knows Luisa. And he knows now how Luisa is going to bring a change to the world. To the world. See, we're not talking... Remember what Father Bucci said. St. Francis was for his time. St. John of the Cross was for his time. Luisa is for our time. You cannot believe what God's got planned. And as you read these 36 volumes, you're going to... I remember I said that to one priest. He goes, "How many volumes?" I said, 36. "Who's going to read this?" I said, "I'm going to read it. This is just spectacular. I've read John of the Cross. I've read Treatise of Avila. I've read Catherine of Siena, the beautiful, holy, saintly. But it doesn't compare an iota to Luisa. What Jesus tells Luisa is so amazing that basically, like I said before, you begin to live heaven on earth. There's no more worry, no more fear, no anxiety, no more complaints if you're linked to Luisa. If you're living in your own human misery, you're going to be worried, fearful, anxious, complaining, and negative. Guarantee you. I mean, thank God I'm not like that. Yeah, those that know me go, "Holy, how can you talk about the divine will?" All right, but it's the divine will is so beautiful. And that's where God wants us to live. He wants us to live heaven on earth. So he says very clearly, I call you, Luisa, the cathedral, the seat. This is the chair of Moses, the chair of Peter, the chair of the bishop, the cathedral of my divine will, the secretary of the most intimate secrets, such that as you, Luisa, were unable to contain them all within yourself, I, God, commanded you to manifest them to Father Inibele. And this acting of mine was necessary. Otherwise, how would my divine will have ever become known? So Father Inibele was the first one to publish these. He was the very first one. And when he got to heaven, he returned and he said to Luisa, "If I had known how important these were," I mean, he knew how beautiful they were, he says, I would have published everything. And it's now they are published. And he only read 1 to 19. We have 1 to 36. This is astonishing. And as you read, especially as you get into the higher volumes, there's nothing you can do but to be in awe of what God is doing. And I remember reading, I was reading volume 13. I've said this to you before, but I was down in Atlanta at the airport, and all these people are walking by, and I wanted to go, don't you know what's coming? I mean, everybody is in their own little world. Everybody is in their own misery. Everybody is in their own worry, own fear, own anxiety, own negativity. And Jesus says, I've got something that, he says that to Louisa, no one is ready for what I am going to do. It's going to catch everybody completely off guard, what God is going to do. Volume 26, September 8th, 1929. Now my daughter, Louisa, the one who lives in my divine will, renews her rebirth and redoubles the rebirth for all human generations. Again, when you wake up in the morning and you do your Pravini Act, and the Pravini Act is found May 27th, 1922, volume 14, I think. What do you do? Every thought, every word, every deed, Lord, I want it to glorify you, worship you, praise you, adore you, love you, in the name of everyone and everything, past, present, and future. See, the divine will, the prayer of the divine will isn't a devotional prayer. The prayer of the divine will is a universal prayer. It's to take everybody that's ever lived, from the beginning of mankind to the end of mankind, taking everybody's heartbeat, everybody's breath, and in your name, linked to Louisa, you say to God, I love you. How many heartbeats do you have? How many heartbeats has anybody ever beat in their entire life? Every one of those, past, present, and future, is an I love you to God. There's an explosion of I love yous going to the throne of God. Every breath, how many breaths have you taken? How many breaths has everybody taken? Everyone, I love you to God. An explosion of I love yous. Heaven is here on earth. Heaven comes down from heaven through Louisa and goes back. Louisa is like that neck in the hourglass. All of heaven is above, all of earth is below. That's what the church is going to explain when it beatifies Louisa. All this, I love you. The devil can't stay here. The devil can't stay on earth when heaven is here. He has to leave. All evil is going to be gone. Again, this is not about living the redemptive life. It's now going from that to the third stage of sanctification, to live heaven on earth. And that's why what's so amazing is Jesus says, Louisa, who lives in the divine will, renews her rebirth. She redoubles her rebirth for every single human person, past, present, and future. Again, this life, see, God is, he says, I am a God of the living, not of the dead. God wants us to live this abundant life. So as you begin your Pravini Act in the morning and your actual acts throughout the day, it's when you're washing the dishes. You look at the bubbles. For every bubble that ever bubbled, I love you, I praise you, I thank you, I glorify you. In every bubble that ever, ever existed, you walk out and you get sand in between your toes. For every grain of sand that ever existed, I love you, I praise you, I thank you, I glorify. For every leaf on a tree, for every blade of grass, I love May because it's an explosion of flowers. And Jesus says, these are all I love yous from God to us. And we can give all these I love yous back to God. Not only here in your yard, but every flower that ever existed from the beginning of time to the end of time. Again, in the divine will, there's no time or space. And what we want to do is we want to learn how to pray these rounds so that we can begin to give this an explosion of I love yous back to the Father, back to the Son, back to the Holy Spirit, back to our triune God. Again, this is, you begin to live heaven on earth. You begin, this, I can't explain. any better that you go outside and in the contemplative life, you're loving God in the name of everyone and everything, past, present, and future. It's not just a devotional life as the saints had, but an actual life of Jesus and Mary through Louisa. This is what our God is saying. That's why he says it's a rebirth for all human generations. So when my supreme divine will lives inside Louisa's heart, or anybody's heart linked to Louisa, and lays the fullness of its endless light within that heart, the divine will centralizes everything and everyone. It centralizes, it does everything and renews everything and gives back to all for all centuries upon centuries. The divine will has not been able to give through all the other souls, all the other saints. So Jesus is saying we have to begin to understand that what our God is calling us to is not just a good life, a holy life, a saintly life, which we've been striving for 2,000 years to do, but a divine life. And nobody has it yet except Louisa. And that's why the more we grow closer to Louisa, the more we begin to recognize that God had to do this. He could do nothing less than this to give us divine life again. God has to do this. And he chose, as he said, the littlest of all souls, Louisa Picaretta. And when you look at Louisa, you know, there's no pictures of her young. As a matter of fact, when you go to Corrado, you'll see one young picture of Louisa. They say she was 18 when the picture was taken. And you know how when you get too close to a person and flash the light, you don't see the face? You see everything but her face. And that's Louisa. See, God does not want us to have a picture like St. Teresa, the little beautiful flower. God doesn't want us to have a picture like St. Gemma. God doesn't want us to have a picture of Louisa. Why? Because with the eyes, the human eyes, you see an old woman in bed. With divine eyes, with Jesus' eyes, you see the little daughter of the divine will. And see, that's what our God, a lot of people look at Louisa and go, thank you, but no thank you. An old woman in bed, that's exactly what I want. And they walk away from Louisa. Louisa is the little daughter of the divine will. And Jesus says in volume 12, I, God, cannot live without Louisa. If Jesus is saying this, where is our life for Louisa? So this soul, Louisa, can be called the dawn of the day. Our Lady says, I am the dawn of the new day. Okay? Louisa is now the dawn of this third day, if you want to say, this eighth day, the third era. The daybreak that calls the sun that gladdens all the earth, the sun that illuminates the earth, the sun that warms the earth, and with its wings of light, more than a tender mother embraces everything, fecundates everything, and with its kiss of light, this sun gives the most beautiful tints to the flowers, the most delicious sweetness to the fruits, the maturity to all plants. Oh, if my holy divine will reigned in the midst of all souls, how many prodigies would the divine will not operate in their midst? So Jesus is saying there is a new dawn. There is a new sun that's going to give light and life to everyone and everything. And those are the words of St. Honorable, St. Padre Pio. Therefore, Louisa, be attentive. Everything you do, Louisa, in my divine will is a rebirth that you, Louisa, have in the divine will. And to be reborn in the divine will means to be reborn in the divine order. Not in the human order. To be reborn in the divine light, to be reborn in the divine sanctity, and to be reborn in the divine love, to be reborn in the divine beauty. And in each act of my divine will, the human will undergoes a death, the human will dies to all evils, and the human will lives again to all that is of God. This is what our God wants. And this is why it's so essential that we become Catholic again. to be contemplative again, to be alone with God again, to walk and talk with God in the cool of the evening again. Our God has great plans. Vine 24 of November 14th, 1929. Now my daughter, Louisa, the one who lives in my divine will, possesses the rights of her creation. Again, as Adam was Lord of creation, Louisa, again, receives the rights of creation. There's not going to be any tornadoes or hurricanes or earthquakes or floods or famines anymore. Jesus says about the Sahara Desert, he goes, you know why the Sahara Desert is there? He says it's because Adam fell. He says that desert should be packed with people. And if you look at the Sahara Desert from Google Earth, from sky, from the heavens, you'll see there were rivers there. There were rivers in the Sahara Desert, streams in the Sahara Desert. But Jesus says it became dead because Adam fell. God wants to bring about life. And what he says is packed with life. That's the word he used. Packed with life. God is God of the living. And all these people that have zero population growth, it's awful. God loves life. And this, the woman that just had the 8 children, they're ridiculing her and torturing her and, you know, mocking her. But she didn't kill any of her children. If she had killed her children, she'd be fine. You got the governor from Alaska. 90% of people who have children with Down syndrome abort them. She didn't, so she's ridiculed and hated. You had a president that was pro-life, ridiculed and hated. Why? Because there's the people that want abortion, that's their sacrament. They have to kill babies. The blood of babies is their sacrament. And even if they can't kill as many babies, then they'll kill fetuses for stem cell research. They have to kill babies. Again, Jesus says, my Father's the Father of the living, not of the dead. You know, what church are we part of? If we're a part that wants to kill babies, it's just not good. Jesus says in Mark 3, verse 4 and 5, he says, is it better to preserve life or to destroy it? And they were silent. And Jesus looked at them with anger because they were silent. They wouldn't tell the truth. Which is better, to preserve life or to destroy it? Again, what our God wants for us is he wants to give us life. But if we're not living, if we don't understand human life, we're never going to understand divine life. So, therefore, more than a son, Louisa lives in the unity of her God. Louisa is the reproducer of the effects of the divine unity. And in this divine unity, Louisa gathers everything. Louisa embraces everyone. Louisa warms everyone. And with the breath of the divine unity that Louisa has, Louisa produces the hearts of all souls and all the effects that are in the present, that are present in the kingdom of grace, the kingdom of the divine will. But while more than son, Louisa, more than a son, this is what Jesus is saying. Louisa plays in touching everything. And with Louisa's touches, Louisa gives sanctity. Louisa gives virtue. Louisa gives love. Louisa gives sweetness that are all divine. Louisa will want to close everyone in the unity of her God. Why? Because Louisa possesses the true life of Jesus and the true life of Mary. She has nothing of her own. She possesses the true life of Jesus and the true life of Mary that we want. And if we want this true life of Jesus and the true life of Mary, we go to the one who possesses it. Louisa Picaretta. So we'll end there and come back in 15 minutes in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit.
Thank you for joining us today. We will see you next week. Fiat.
Dearest Lord Jesus, I thank you for your lessons of today. Free me from living one single instant outside of your will. Have pity on me and do not permit that I either know or acquire any other life except that of your divine will. Fiat et amen. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.